Hey, what's up guys? My name is Acherno and welcome back to my OpenGL series. So, today we're going to be talking all about uniforms. What is a uniform in OpenGL or in graphics programming in general? What are they used for and how do they work in OpenGL? So first of all, uniforms are a pretty simple concept. They're basically just a way for us to actually get data from the kind of CPU side of things, so from C++ in this case, into our shader so that we can actually use it like a variable. So a really good example of that, we're just gonna jump into some code straight away today. A really good example of this is in our current application, if I just run that for you guys to refresh your memory, we have a blue kind of square or rectangle that we're actually drawing over here. If we take a look at the shader code, the way that we're actually getting that blue color is just by hard coding a color here, right? 0.2 red, 0.3 green, and 0.8 blue with a 1.0 alpha. Now, it would be great if we could somehow define this data in the CPU side of things, so in our actual C++, and possibly even update it as necessary. So the good news is we can do that. And there's two main ways of doing that. Today we're going to look at uniforms, but it's also possible, as you guys could probably tell from the Vertex kind of video, it's also possible for us to actually get data from the CPU to the GPU via a Vertex buffer. And if you guys haven't seen that video, definitely check that out over there. But today, we're going to be focusing on uniforms. I am actually planning to make a comparison video between attributes and uniforms because those are kind of the two main ways of getting data kind of per object kind of that we're drawing from the CPU to the GPU. But today, again, explicitly about uniforms. So in terms of just comparing the two lightly, the big thing that you do have to know is that uniforms are set per draw. So basically, you can set a uniform up before you call GL draw elements or GL draw arrays or whatever you're using to actually do the drawing. Whereas attributes are actually set kind of per vertex. So in other words, you can see that obviously the position attribute we have here, which theoretically could be any kind of data, in this case though it's a position, this is per vertex. Whereas with uniforms, we kind of set them before we do the actual drawing. So they're set per draw. That's a really big difference. And again, we'll explore that more in the dedicated video about that. So let's convert this color into being something that we set from C++. So the first thing I'm actually going to do is modify my shader. I'm going to go into my shader file here, and into this fragment shader, I'm going to add some code. So just underneath this output that we actually have here, I'm going to write uniform vec4. U_color. Now I like to use a bit of a naming convention here. I didn't really use it for attributes or anything, but as we get into uniforms, I'm going to start using it. Basically, anything that begins with a U_ is an actual uniform variable. And in this particular case, it's actually necessary for me to differentiate this variable from, of course, the variable that is our actual output color. So that's all I have to do in my shader. That's it. I've declared a uniform. I can now use this uniform throughout my shader code. And in fact, what I'm going to do is replace this color with U_color like this. So we're basically assigning the output color of each fragment, of each pixel of our actual rectangle to be whatever this uniform value actually is. So now all that's left to do is to actually set that uniform from C++. So the two things that matter here are the type of the variable, which is a vec4, a four component vector, we need to remember that, as well as the name, so U_color like that. Okay, let's go back to application and set this up. So what I'm going to do is after my shader is actually bound, right? So I've actually called glUseProgram. You have to have a shader that's actually bound when you actually do this so that it knows which shader to send data to. What I'm going to do here is called glUniform. And then we have a variety of functions that you guys can actually check out in the documentation. Basically, the difference here is the type of data that we're actually sending and how many components we have. So how many floats are we sending or how many integers are we sending? Now, in this case, we know it's a vec4, which is a four component kind of, which is basically just four floats. So we need to choose glUniform for f, okay? So four because there's four of them and f because they're floats. The first parameter here is the location of this variable, and you can see that it's actually an int. So what we need to do before we even call this is actually retrieve the location of this variable. So what OpenGL does is once our shader gets created, every uniform basically gets assigned an ID so that we can then reference it. And the way that we look up that ID typically is by its name. So we can basically ask our shader, hey, this U_color variable, please tell me what the location of that variable is, and then we'll get an integer back. In more modern versions of OpenGL, you can actually set an index, kind of the same way that we're actually setting this kind of layout location equals zero. So you can specify an explicit uniform location starting with OpenGL 4.3. So it is quite a modern kind of new feature, which is why I don't really like using it too much. And in this case, we're just going to retrieve it by using the name because that's fine. So if we go back to application, what I'm going to do is just write int location equals gl get uniform location. And then we specify the program, which is our shader, as well as the name of the uniform we're trying to retrieve. So in this case, it's u underscore color. Make sure that you obviously spell this and use the exact same casing as you do with the actual variable name in your shader here. Because if you don't, then it's not going to work out. Now, we do have an assert macro, so I'm going to use it here and just assert that location does not equal -1. If we get the location -1, it means that it could not find our uniform. Now, that actually might be okay, because what you might not realize immediately is that that doesn't mean necessarily that you've made an error or that you've made a spelling mistake or something like that with your actual uniform name. If you don't use that uniform throughout your shader, so you have that uniform actually present in your shader, but it's unused, then OpenGL will just strip that when it compiles the shader. So this might actually return -1 if it be, because the uniform's been removed, it's been unused. So you don't necessarily want to write out error or crash your program if it doesn't find your uniform, because you might have just rewritten the shader and maybe forgotten to remove it, or maybe you want it for later or whatever. So just keep that in mind. In this case, I'm just asserting it because I do actually plan on using it, and I want to make sure that I've actually done everything correctly. So now that we have a location, I'm going to feed that into here as the first parameter. And then you can see that we need to set four floats. So the first one I'm going to set is 0.2f, then 0.3f, basically the same code that I had before, 0.8f and 1.0f. So I've effectively moved my code from the shader into C++. And finally, I'm just going to wrap this int location call and this gl uniform call in my gl call macro to make sure we don't have any errors. All right, so to summarize, I'm binding my shader by writing gluse program with that actual shader ID. I'm retrieving the location of this actual color variable. And then once I've retrieved that location, I'm calling gluniform 4f with that location integer, as well as the value so that I actually set my data in my shader. And in the shader, all I've done is created a uniform by typing the keyword uniform, along with the type and the name, just like any other variable. And I'm using my uniform here to actually write to the output color. So if everything goes correctly, I should be writing this color value into my actual output color for every single pixel in my rectangle. Let's run this program. And you can see we get the exact same result as before. So perfect, it's working. One other thing that we can do to check, just because obviously I am using the same color here, I'll just change the red channel to be 0.8, so we should get much more of a pink color here. And you can see, there it is. Perfect. Okay, so now let's do something a little bit more exciting. Let's actually animate this color and change it over time in our rendering loop. So back over here, I'm going to basically just set this uniform right before I draw my actual rectangle. So I'll copy and paste this code over here. I'll make a float called R, which will be our red channel. I'll set that equal to 0.0 to begin with. I'm going to feed in that R variable instead of 0.8 as the red channel, and then I'll just add a little bit of logic to animate it. So one thing I'm going to do here is set my increment to be 0.05f to begin with. If my R value is greater than 1.0f, I'm actually going to set my increment to be -0.05f. Otherwise, if r is less than 0, I'm going to set my increment to be +0.05f. I'm not going to bother clamping r or anything like that, because this is just a test really. And then finally, r plus equals increment. So what this should do is basically just bounce between 1 and 0 for the red channel. So let's run this. And you can see what we get here is a very party mode looking rectangle going very, very quickly because we're not actually limiting our frame rate. So let's have a go at doing that. What I'm going to do is scroll up over here to where we actually create our window. And what I'm going to do once we have an OpenGL context is just set the glfw swap interval to 1, which should just synchronize this with our VSync, or otherwise our monitor's refresh rate, which for me is 60. So let's hit F5. And you can see we get a much smoother animation here. And that's pretty much it. That's what uniforms are in OpenGL. That's how you use them. It's really, really simple. Of course, in this case, we're just using four floats as an example, but you can use really any data type or any kind of number of components that you need to. So floats, integers, matrices, all of that stuff. We'll definitely be getting into that a lot more in the future. Uniforms are a really vital part of graphics programming and of OpenGL and all that. So as we actually start to build more and more, we'll be using them all the time. The really big thing that you need to keep in mind though is that uniforms are actually per draw. So obviously we set uniform 4F and then we draw our entire piece of geometry, which in this case is just a rectangle. So they are actual separate OpenGL calls, so of course we can't in any way define uniforms or change uniforms, I should say, in between kind of drawing this. So if I had, in this case I'm obviously drawing two triangles, I can't draw one of them with one color and one with the other color if it's set up this way, because at this point in time they're actually being drawn together in one draw call and uniforms are set per draw. If I actually wanted those two triangles that make up our square to actually be different colors, I would need to do that via a vertex attribute essentially, and we can definitely talk about that in the future. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, you can hit that like button. You can also support this series and everything that I do here on this channel by going over to patreon.com/thechurno. You'll get access to all the source code for these OpenGL videos, as well as some other exciting rewards, which you can check out by going to the link. Discord is another really cool thing that I like to promote, because there's basically what Discord is a community of people with which you can talk about all this OpenGL stuff or any other programming stuff. So Discord, thechurno.com/Discord, I always get that URL wrong. Go to thechurno.com/Discord and join that server. It's a great time. You can discuss this episode and all of the stuff that is related to programming. Maybe you're working on a project and you need some help. That's a great place to get it. Next time, we're going to probably move on to some more exciting shader stuff. I really want to start kind of abstracting this stuff out, and because we'll have to eventually kind of move this code into classes, because we'll be reusing a lot of it when we actually get down to drawing models and all of that stuff. So that's probably what's going to be in the next episode. There were a few other things that I definitely need to mention though. So I will see you guys in the next video. Goodbye.